endures forever.
Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hidden, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Lord, have mercy.
Christ have mercy.
Lord, have mercy. Glory to God in the highest,
and peace to his people on earth.
Lord God, heavenly King,
almighty God and Father,
we worship you, we give you thanks, we praise you for your glory.
Lord Jesus Christ,
only Son of Father,
Lord God, Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world, have mercy on us. You are seated at the right hand of the Father, receive our prayer. For you alone are the Holy One, you alone are the Lord, you alone are the Most High, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit, in the glory of God the Father.
Amen. The Lord be with you,
and also with you.
Let us pray. Almighty God, you called Cuthbert from following the flock to be a shepherd of your people. Mercifully grant that as he sought in dangerous and remote places, that those who had erred and strayed from their ways, so we may seek the indifferent and the lost, and lead them back to you. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever.
Amen.
A reading from the second epistle of St. Paul to the Corinthians. As we work together with him, we urge you not to accept the grace of God in vain. For as he says, at an acceptable time I have listened to you, and on a day of salvation I have helped you. See, now is the acceptable time. See, now is the day of salvation. We are putting no obstacle in anyone's way, so that no fault may be found with our ministry. But as servants of God, we have commended ourselves in every way through great endurance in afflictions, hardships, calamities, beatings, imprisonments, riots, labors, sleepless nights, hunger, by purity, knowledge, patience, kindness, holiness of spirit, genuine love, truthful speech, and the power of God. With the weapons of righteousness for the right hand and for the left, in honor and in dishonor, in ill repute and good repute. We are treated as impostors and yet are true, as unknown and yet we are well known, as dying and see we are alive, as punished and yet not killed, as sorrowful yet always rejoicing, as poor yet making many rich, as having nothing and yet possessing everything. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The psalm appointed for today is the 23rd psalm, which we'll recite together in unison. It's found on page 612 of the Book of Common Prayer, Psalm 23. The Lord is my shepherd. I shall not be in want. He makes me lie down in green pastures and leads me beside still waters. He revives my soul and guides me along right pathways for his name's sake. Though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I shall fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You spread a table before me in the presence of those who trouble me. You have anointed my head with oil, and my cup is running over. Surely your goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. The Lord be with you,
and also with you.
The Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ, according to Matthew.
Glory to you, Lord Christ.
Jesus said, "No one can serve two masters, for a slave will either hate the one and love the other, or be devoted to the one and despise the other. You cannot serve God and wealth. Therefore, I tell you, do not worry about your life, what you will eat or what you will drink, or about your body, what you will wear. Is not life more than food, and the body more than clothing? Look at the birds of the air. They neither sow nor reap nor gather into barns, and yet your heavenly Father feeds them. Are you not of more value than they? And can any of you, by worrying, add a single hour to your span of life? And why do you worry about clothing? Consider the lilies of the field, how they grow. They neither toil nor spin. Yet I tell you, even Solomon in all his glory was not clothed like one of these. But if God so clothes the grass of the field, which is alive today and tomorrow is thrown into the oven, will he not much more clothe you, you of little faith? Therefore do not worry, saying, what will we eat, or what will we drink, or what will we wear? For it is the Gentiles who strive for all these things, and indeed your heavenly Father knows that you need all these things. But strive first for the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things will be given to you as well. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
In the name of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. Today we celebrate the feast of Saint Cuthbert, and while he's not an esoteric saint, you might not know much about him, so I'll read something to you about him. He was the most popular saint of the pre-conquest Anglo-Saxon Church, and born about the year 625. The Venerable Bede, who wrote A Life of Cuthbert, tells us that in his youth, while tending sheep one night and praying, as was his wont, he saw a stream of light break through the darkness, and in its midst a company of the heavenly host descended to the earth, and having received among them a spirit of surpassing brightness, returned without delay to their heavenly home. Learning the next day that Aidan of Lindisfarne had died at that very time, Cuthbert determined forthwith to enter a monastery. Trained in the austere traditions of Celtic monasticism, Cuthbert was the prior of Melrose Abbey from 651 to 664, and then of Lindisfarne for 12 years. Bede says that he was accustomed to make visitations even to remote villages and to preach to simple folk who, neglecting the sacrament of their creed, had recourse to idolatrous remedies, as if by charms or amulets or any other mysteries of the magical art, they were able to avert a stroke inflicted upon them by the Lord. Bede says that Cuthbert often remained a week, sometimes two or three, nay, even a whole month, without returning home, but dwelling among the mountains, taught the poor people both by words of his preaching and also by his own holy conduct. Archbishop Theodore recognized Cuthbert's greatness of character and made him Bishop of Hexham in 684, but Cuthbert continued to make his see at Lindisfarne. He returned 2 years later to his hermitage on the neighboring island of Farne, where he died on March 20th, 687. Cuthbert accepted the decisions of the Synod of Whitby in 663 that brought the usages of the English Church into line with the Roman practice. He was thus a healer of the breach that threatened to divide the Church into Celtic and Roman factions. At the time of the Viking invasions, the monks of Lindisfarne carefully protected his relics during their wanderings until finally they brought him to Durham, where one may see today the remnants of his shrine and visit his tomb. Cuthbert lived at a time when there were at least the remnants of yellow fever, plague of yellow fever moving throughout England. He contracted the disease himself and had some complications throughout his life, although he did eventually recover. He dealt with the complications of his life for the rest of his life. I have to say, I think Jesus has his nerve on a day like today, telling us not to be anxious, as we hear in that marvelous section of the sixth chapter of Matthew's Gospel, a chapter that I have often resorted to and told people under all kinds of circumstances that they should read, because it seems like such good advice. Don't be anxious. Consider the lilies of the field. They neither toil nor spin. Yet God has arrayed them in all their glory, and none of us is arrayed with the beauty of these. It's a lovely thought, but hard to integrate into our lives just at the moment. Cuthbert, however, may have something to tell us about anxiety. I came across a beautiful little legend of St. Cuthbert that I want to share with you. On one of his visits to a neighboring monastery, it's said that a young monk witnessed this happen. That Cuthbert rose in the middle of the night, and he walked to the beach, and on the beach, he went and walked into the water and stood up to his shoulders in the water, chanting psalms to the waves for hours. When he left the water, two sea otters followed him. They dried his feet with their fur, and they breathed on him with their breath until he was warm. And so Cuthbert returned to his prayers at the monastery. Of course, this is a legend, right? I mean, who knows what the chances are that Cuthbert actually rose in the middle of the night, that sea otters followed him, and they dried his feet with their fur, and they breathed on him with his breath. Who knows? I'm not interested in knowing whether or not that really happened. I'm interested in the confidence and faith of people who are willing to tell a story about a man like that, and to tell a story about a God who will send his sea otters to care for those who are faithful, who will take the trouble to dry the feet of the faithful with the fur of sea otters and warm them with their breath. I'm interested in that kind of faith, not because it's outrageous, but because it's beautiful and expansive. I've been saying in church more often in recent months that quoting an old professor of mine who said that we believe in the love of a commodious God. A commodious God is willing to deploy his sea otters to a holy man or woman to dry their feet and to warm them with his breath. Maybe that only happens in dreams. But a dream like that wouldn't hurt me at this moment. And maybe it wouldn't hurt you if you go to bed tonight anxious about the many things you might be anxious about, dubious about whether you can be as confident in God as the lilies of the field can be. Maybe it wouldn't be helpful to have a dream of St. Cuthbert, to see the image of him walking and shivering out of the water, and see those two sea otters follow him, to see them dry his feet, warm him with their breath, and then look to you in your sleep and promise and offer to do the same for you and for me. May God grant us such dreams and cause to put aside our anxiety. In the name of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. Now let us pray for the church and for the world using Form 6 of the Prayers of the People, which are found on page 392 of the Book of Common Prayer. In peace we pray to you, Lord God. For all people in their daily life and work,
for our families, friends, and neighbors, and for those who are alone,
for this community, the nation, and the world,
for all who work for justice, freedom, and peace,
for the just and proper use of your creation,
for the victims of hunger, fear, injustice, and oppression,
for all who are in danger, sorrow, or any kind of trouble,
for those who minister to the sick, the friendless, and the needy,
for the peace and unity of the Church of God,
for all who proclaim the gospel, and all who seek the truth,
for Justin, the Archbishop of Canterbury, for Michael, our presiding bishop, for Daniel, our bishop, for Kyle, Nora, Stephen, Nicholas, and Gordon, my priest brothers and sisters who worship and work in this place and parish, and for all bishops and other ministers,
for all who serve God in his church,
for the special needs and concerns of this congregation, remembering especially all those who are anxious, worry, or in trouble at this time of peril, for those who lost their jobs, for those who are insecure in where their shelter or food is to come from, for those who are anxious for their children or for their parents, for their siblings, for their friends, for those who are anxious in any way because of the current worries that so occupy our minds and our time. Continuing also to pray for all those in this parish who are in particular need of prayer, especially remembering at this time to pray for Tom, George, Bob, Mary Jane, John, Kent John, Chris, Sue, George, Mary, Nathan, Sam, and all those who we remember in the silence of our hearts. Continuing also to pray for peace in our time, for an end to the war in Syria, for relief to refugees who are in search of a home, for relief to those who are living in great poverty, especially those whose lives are in even greater peril due to their poverty at this time, for those who are homeless and hungry, for those who are lost, frightened, or afraid, those who are suffering with addictions, those who are struggling with mental illness, for those who are languishing in prison, for those who are suffering in old age, and particularly suffering the indignities of old age, for those who are living in fear, worry, and anxiety, and for all those who suffer in any way in body, mind, or estate. Hear us, Lord.
For your mercy is great.
We thank you, Lord, for all the blessings of this life, giving thanks especially for the beauty of this day, giving thanks for the gifts that technology brings to us, allowing us to communicate more readily and easily and immediately with one another, giving thanks for all those who join their prayers with ours from afar, and for all those who offer their ministry and support to this parish during a time of unusual ministry and distancing. We will exalt you, O God, our King,
and praise your name forever and ever.
We pray for all who have died, that they may have a place in your eternal kingdom, remembering especially all those whose lives have been taken from them in the current pandemic, and also all those whose lives have been taken in acts of war and violence in recent days. Lord, let your loving kindness be upon them,
who put their trust in you.
We pray to you also for the forgiveness of our sins. Have mercy upon us,
most merciful Father. In your compassion, forgive us our sins, known and unknown, things done and left undone. And so uphold us by your Spirit, that we may live and serve you in newness of life, to the honor and glory of your name, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Almighty God, have mercy on you. Forgive you all your sins through our Lord Jesus Christ. Strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life. Amen. The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
Make me a clean heart, O God, and renew a right spirit within me. Thank you.
God forever.
Blessed are you, Lord God of all creation. Of your goodness we have this wine to offer, fruit of the vine and work of human hands. It will become for us our spiritual drink.
Blessed be God forever.
Pray, brothers and sisters, that this, my sacrifice and yours, may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father.
May the Lord accept this sacrifice at your hands, to the praise and glory of his name, both for our good and that of all his holy Church.
Amen. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks unto the Lord our God.
It is right to give him thanks and praise.
It is right and a good and joyful thing always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. Because of the obedience of your saints, you have given us an example of righteousness, and in their eternal joy, a glorious pledge of the hope of our calling. Therefore, we praise you, joining our voices with angels and archangels, and with all the company of heaven, who forever sing this hymn to proclaim the glory of your name.
Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna.
We give thanks to you, O God, for the goodness and love which you have made known to us in creation, in the calling of Israel to be your people, in your word spoken through the prophets, and above all, in the word made flesh, Jesus, your Son. For in these last days, you sent him to be incarnate from the Virgin Mary, to be the Savior and Redeemer of the world. In him you have delivered us from evil and made us worthy to stand before you. In him you have brought us out of error into truth, out of sin into righteousness, out of death into life. On the night before he died for us, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread, and when he had given thanks to you, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper, he took the cup of wine, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you, for this is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Therefore, according to his command, O Father, we remember his death, we proclaim his resurrection, we await his coming in glory, and we offer our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving to you, O Lord of all, presenting to you from your creation this bread and this wine, We pray you, gracious God, to send your Holy Spirit upon these gifts, that they may be the sacrament of the body of Christ and his blood of the new covenant. Unite us to your Son in his sacrifice, that we may be acceptable through him, being sanctified by the Holy Spirit. In the fullness of time, put all things in subjection under your Christ, and bring us to that heavenly country where with the ever-blessed Virgin Mary, the Mother of God, with blessed Mark the Evangelist, with blessed Cuthbert, and with all your saints, we may enter the everlasting heritage of your sons and daughters, through Jesus Christ our Lord, the firstborn of all creation, the head of the Church, and the author of our salvation. By him, and with him, and in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen. And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to say, Our Father, who art in heaven,
hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Christ, our Passover, is sacrificed for us.
Therefore, let us keep the feast.
Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world.
Have mercy on us.
Lamb of God,
you take away the sins of the world.
Have mercy on us.
Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world.
Grant us peace. Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Happy are we who are called to his supper.
Lord, I am not worthy to receive you, but speak the word only, and my soul shall be healed.
Body,
who have fed us with spiritual food in the sacrament of his body and blood. Send us now to the world in peace, and grant us strength and courage to love and serve you with gladness and singleness of heart. Through Christ our Lord. Amen.
May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. May the Lord lift up the light of his countenance upon you and give you peace. And may the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be upon you and remain with you this day and forevermore. Amen. Let us pray. O most mighty and merciful God, in this time of grievous sickness, we flee unto thee for succor. Deliver us, we beseech thee, from our peril. Give strength and skill to all those who minister to the sick. Prosper the means made use of for their cure, and grant that, perceiving how frail and uncertain our life is, we may apply our hearts unto that heavenly wisdom which leadeth to eternal life, through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Amen.